So, welcome again to our Proverbs chat. And today I'm joined by Jeff, Ken, Peter, and Victor. And to start us off, we have Jeff giving us a recap of last week.
All right, thank you, Cheryl. We started off with a Proverbs challenge, the chat that is last week on Sunday. And today we are glad to bring you another episode of that. We've been doing the Proverbs challenge from the beginning of July, the 31 days of July. We are doing the 31 chapters of Proverbs. And today we just went, last week we talked about the book of Proverbs, how it is set, a father talking to his youthful son. We talked a lot on the imagery that he uses to bring the point home. And I think we talked a lot. I think today I'll just recap on a few things. This week was starting from date 12, is it? Yeah, 12 to day 19.
Yes.
Yeah, so, but I think maybe in chapter 10, 11, maybe there was a few things probably we could have also talked about, and that's probably what I want to highlight. And it's important to note that the actual proverb starts in chapter 10, because that's when if you read most of the Bibles up there, it's written in chapter 10, the Proverbs of Solomon. So actually, the actual Proverbs starts in chapter 10, because the previous chapters is just talking about why wisdom. And then we come to 10, then he starts the real sayings. And I think in chapter 10, we see him saying that the memory of the righteous is blessed. And we were sharing the group and we were saying that a lot of the time that this verse is used is on students when they are doing exams. But we realized that is misplaced. That it doesn't mean that your memory, remembrance on your doing exam is blessed. It actually means the way I think there's actually, if you read several versions, it will show you exactly what it means. Like in NIV, it says the name of the righteous is used in blessings, but the name of the wicked will rot. Meaning, and you are sharing the same, when you interact with a righteous person, you will remember that with a lot of, you know, joy. And I don't know, that tells you, if you want to know whether someone is righteous or not, remember the moment you shared with them. There are people you met in your life, and all you can remember is after you shared with them your secrets, they went spreading your secrets. So you are like, I hate the day I met that person as a friend. But the Bible says in Proverbs 10 that the memory of the righteous is blessed. Every time you interact with righteous people, that's why even as Rev was saying in the service, it is important for righteous people to continue congregating. Because every time you congregate, you walk out blessed. You remember the moment that we share together blessed. That's why you should not forsake gathering together with brethren. As young people, you need to connect with a fellowship so that and you realize that every time you remember of it, there's a blessing that came out of it. And the thing is, maybe endeavor to be people, but when we have interacted for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you go home blessed. The people you interact with at school, at work, you know, at home, in church, let them be left with something good to say about you. Because the memory of the righteous is blessed. Another thing that it means also is that when you leave this world, people will remember you with very good and sweet memories. People will remember how you helped the church, how you helped your youth ministry, how you did, like, how does your former high school remember you? Were you the person who sold drugs? Or were you someone who was in the front line, you know, helping people in ministry and all those things? So, how are you remembered? That's what the verse talks about. So, he's urging his son to be very careful on how he lives, so that even when he departs, he will be remembered fondly. I think that's what I would want to recap from last week. Maybe someone else can take us probably from 12, 13, you know, whether someone has something to say.
Good afternoon, church. Like we've learned from our senior Jeff, we've been going through the book of Proverbs since the beginning of this month, a chapter each day, and we've been growing in knowledge and in understanding, and we are here to share that insight with you. So what I gathered from the chapter 12 and 13 is the true nature of wisdom. What is wisdom? What I understood from my apply knowledge in order to make good decisions. And that the author of that book is Solomon, emphasized with so much zeal that you should acquire wisdom over everything else. And he equated it to be more precious than riches and wealth. That's how he found wisdom to have so much value, because it affects every other spheres of our lives. If you are to make good decisions in your relationships, maybe with family, with other people who you relate with in your community, you need wisdom for all of that. If you are to excel, for the young people maybe who are pursuing academics, and for those who are pursuing their careers, you need at some point in time, you may need to make good decisions. And those good decisions will come from how you apply knowledge to make those good decisions. So wisdom came out as priceless, according to how I understood that goes to Japanese.
Yeah, and maybe I can add something on Proverbs 12:9. Better to be ordinary and work for a living than act important and starve in your places. Nowadays, as we go through social media, we're seeing very different people from the people we know, people who try and be people who are not, because they want either to make a social statement or to get people to like them. And in the process, they might end up hurting themselves. They might end up, as we're told here, starving in the process. So what I learned was that it is better to be ordinary and be yourself briefly than to train with someone you're not.
And I think I also want to add on something from what she said. There's a lot of fake lies. They say, fake it till you make it. That is the slogan of most young people. And I think the right from what she has said, we are trying to shame one another, to do one another. Naturally, you go to verse 12 of chapter 12 of Proverbs, it says that these are jealous of each other's looks, but godly people are well-rooted and bear their own fruit. You find that a lot of people are trying to copy one another. They envy one another, but Solomon tells us that the only people who do that is these, as they admire each other's look. And we see also that really the people we are admiring out there, we never know, they probably have looted and knew God is asking you to be rooted. Wow, on a good people in jail, they are driving big cars or they are living in big houses. But Solomon is telling his son, be rooted, bear your own fruit. So, and I think that really struck me very much, that we should not as young people fall in the temptation of copying and admiring, or rather, let's say envying people. We do not know where they got those things from. We do not know what they have done to be there where they are. Be rooted and bear your own fruit. I think that's what I was getting. And then I also want to highlight something also I think I learned in 13. I think I'll go to 14, eh? And it connects to that. If you read 14:13, chapter 14, verse 9, it says, sure, those people appear to be having a good time, but all that laughter will end in heartbreaks. And then if there is a temptation for young people, you find people, they are going out, they are having the best phone, the latest iPhone, and you don't know how they have gotten that. And there is a temptation for you to also go out there and by every means get that. And they seem to be having a very good life. But all that will end up in tears. It is where we are saying people may be having fun out there, but now, after a short time, you realize these are the people now. We are talking about the teenage pregnancies. And you see, when they put those things out there, you think they are having all fun. And you try copy them. But Solomon would urge his son, those people might be feeling as if they are having fun. But be very careful. It will end in tears. If it's not well rooted in God, it will actually end in tears. So that is a very good warning for us not to copy everything we see out there.
I
can
relate to that. Looks kind of really deceiving. Because even what people tell us about life and their experiences can be very misleading. And you might also want to follow the same path and try and get to where we are out of maybe jealousy or feeling that you're not enough. And in Proverbs 14:15-12, only simple tunes believe in
come before each person that seems right, but it ends in death. And this leads me to questioning myself, how many things in my life are dying because it seemed right, in quotes, right at the time. And ask my fellow youths, what is that is attracting you? What is your attractions? Are you attracted to good things? Are you attracted to bad things? And when you get attracted to bad things, it doesn't lead to satisfaction, it leads to distraction. Distraction from God's purpose concerning your life and to be who God called you to be. So I have an illusion here. When you have a good attraction, it will lead to satisfaction. But when you have a bad attraction, it leads to distraction and subtraction.
Maybe chapter 15, verse 5, it says, a fool despises his father's instructions and correction, but he who regards reproof acquires prudence. Actually, the one thing that has really touched me with the book of Proverbs is how it views a fool. It's quite peculiar and funny somehow, because I've come to realize the father in this aspect is not only the father, the man, you know, it's also the one and our spiritual parents, our spiritual fathers, also, even parents. And most of the times you come to church, you hear, don't do this, don't do that. You've also seen in verse 14, is it verse 14 or 13, where it says, a wise man, you keep good company, keep good company. Most of the time we are told, show me your friends, and I'll tell you who you are. So who are we talking to? Who are we relating to? Who is your friend? Who do you call your brother? Most of us talking about brah. Quotes, yes, don't get it wrong. And ladies, they have funny names also. So the question is, like, okay, how are we related to Kent? Most of the times we share the word. We also share experiences. So by the end of the day, what do I get from? In some aspect, he's more experienced than I am in some things, and I'm more experienced in some things more than he is. Jeff is my spiritual father. What do I look up for him? As in, as I get to talk about it. And do you take it seriously? I'm going to propose it. Until you don't do that, so, your company matters. I'd rather remain with one friend or by myself, and maybe my parents and my brother's siblings, than to have a huge company in Nifanya. I reprove, I rebuke, and I become a brute, a fool. The one who despises correction is like a brute, a beast. Actually, when you come to think of it, it's really scary. Yeah, that's what I can talk about.
I think in chapter 13, there came a very interesting discussion about the rod. Ileki Iboko. And I think it's been a very big debate in Kenya. I think specifically, I don't know, maybe we will address this one day, whether it's a good thing or a bad thing that the rod has been taken away from our schools. But relying and going by the person, the wisest human being who ever lived, he says in chapter 13, verse 24, he that spared his rod hated his son, but he that loved him chastened him betimes, as often. And I think we were talking about this when we were saying it's a very delicate debate in our country today, whether it's right to use the rod or not. But when you look at scripture, you realize it's in the Old Testament, it is in the book of Hebrews, and it's even in Revelation. And I think for those who studied the Bible, they will tell us what you call something that is found in the Old Testament, in the epistles of the apostles, and in the Revelation. That is more of a doctrine. So it's not something you can run away from. I think, and as young people, I think we need to embrace that sometimes requires teachable, especially if someone, maybe the age we are here, maybe we have gone past that. But at some point, Ichapo might not be the kiboko, but it is very important, I think, and this goes to parents especially also, that we should not be afraid of using it. You look at it, and it is through, especially Proverbs, it has really addressed it. If you look at chapter 22, verse 15, it says, Foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child. The rod of correction will drive it far from him. It seems to suggest everyone is born with a degree and a deposit of foolishness. The moment we deviated from God's perfect plan, everyone who is born out of sin comes with a deposit of foolishness. And it takes the rod of correction to drive that out. So I think it's an need to balance. I'm not urging people to beat their children. I'm just saying, do not be afraid to do it. And also my fellow young people, when it comes, and especially those who are in that age, when it comes, please don't despise it. It will help you. It will drive out foolishness. I think it's very, and it's all over scripture. Proverbs 3:11, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord. Neither be wary of his correction. That is now the Lord talking. When you go to 13, we have read. You go to 19. Discipline your children, for in there is hope. Do not be a willing party to their death. That's what Proverbs is saying. Parents, discipline your children. Other, because there is hope in disciplining your children. Otherwise, you'll be a partaker in their death. When they get into drugs and teenage pregnancies and all these things, know that if you can remember a time that you ought to have disciplined them and you didn't, then you end up for it. And it seems to be very, very, I like the way the New Living Translation says, discipline your children when they are so. Otherwise, you will ruin their lives. I think it is very important. I think that was a very, it came out so strongly of what the Bible says about the rod of chastening. So, and I think even as believers think about the chastening of the Lord, young people and parents of young people, think about the chastening by the Lord. I think that came up strong, yes, thank you.
I'll say something in chapter 16. So Proverbs 16:1, the plans of the heart belong to man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. Many of us had planned, 2020, maybe we will get married, or from 4 as well, this is my final year in school, this is like finally I'm getting to high school. But we are told that the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. No, man in his simple ways thinks that he is ever in control and wants to, plan out his life, living the perfect life. But we are told that the Lord God himself holds his way. And that is why Solomon advises his son in Proverbs 16:3, commit your work to the Lord, and your plans will be established. And then we go to Proverbs 16:9. The heart of the man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his steps. And that is what the Lord's person is.
Maybe, okay. Mention something about Proverbs chapter 17 as we were going through this week. Another thing that caught my attention is Proverbs chapter 17, verse 2. Someone who deals wisely will rule over a son who acts shamefully, and will exact and will share the inheritance as one of the brothers. Come to think of it, I mean, the whole book was about sonship and servanthood. If, according to my understanding, is just because I'm a son in the kingdom does not mean I can misbehave and behave in your own. Does not mean that I can just make irrational decisions out of nowhere, like I know I'm a son in the kingdom, so I can decide to spend all this money. It's like the prodigal son, the way he decided, like, I'll just take my share, go out there, live my life, and maybe in his, at the back of his mind, maybe he thought, I'll just go back. I don't know, because it's not mature that way. But come to think of it, a servant, having a servant mentality is a really good thing if only you share the vision with the father. Because even if I'm a son in the kingdom and I don't share the same vision with the father, it means that my inheritance, I won't have anything to do with it. But if I am a servant, with a son mentality, like I know this is my father, this is the one I'm looking upon, and whatever he says and whatever he puts before me, I just deal and follow it. I think that would be very important. And I think for most of the youths, what you should do is to have, even though we know we are sons, we are born again, we should really question ourselves, and we should really ask ourselves, am I really behaving like a true son, a son of blooded morals, or I'm just a son of name. I just love being called a Christian and a son. And in this aspect, when you say a son, I mean also the daughters and sons, not just sons. Singularly in this aspect that only men are allowed in this kingdom. No, it's also ladies. So, am I really sharing the same vision with the Father? Am I a partaker of what he says I should do? Yes, that is what caught my attention for this week.
Also chapter 17, verse 9, he's talking about healthy relationships and forgiveness. It says, I read, you will keep your friends if you forgive them, but you will lose your friends if you keep talking about what they did wrong. So, let us learn not just to forgive, but let us learn not only say that you've forgiven people, but we should also let it go and stop reminding them what they did.
Okay, I think I would also want to add on the whole issue of sonship and servanthood, I must have. But I think we say it and then that, but I want just to say this. What separates someone from being a son in a house and a slave? The servanthood here is being talked about, not the servant that Jesus calls us to be, to serve others, but a slave, is wisdom. It is wisdom that separates whether someone will end up in a slave or a son. And the one he has talked about also, that if you do not capture the vision of that in me, you bring shame to the father, and then you end up sharing with your slaves. But if you are even if you are a slave in that house, and you apply wisdom, you connect with the vision of the father in that place, you are actually to share with the brothers of maybe the sons of that house. So wisdom is very key. It is the one that will determine, even as a kingdom, even as believers, you can be in the house of God and in the kingdom, as part of the kingdom, but you will end up as a slave. You will not grow from the benefits of God. Why? Because you lack wisdom. You can be in the house of God, but you are still living as a slave. But if you have wisdom, you will begin now to live as a son or a daughter in the house. When you say son, you mean also the daughter. So wisdom is very key. And that's why we have come back on this journey to seek for wisdom in all areas.